Good. I love Advent, and I love Advent more and more and more, and perhaps I love Advent more than I love Christmas. Yesterday I wrote this, 10 reasons, you can't read them, they're too small, but 10 reasons why I prefer Advent to Christmas. Christmas is something that happens to us, it's something that overwhelms us and costs us lots of money, whereas Advent is something that we choose to make happen, something that gives us peace, and which is free. Christmas is something that makes it hard, in my experience, to connect with God. I'm always struggling to battle against Christmas to connect with God. Whereas Advent is something that helps me to connect with God. Christmas is over in a day. Advent lasts 4 weeks. Christmas is about getting or receiving something, whereas Advent is always about anticipation, longing, and waiting. Christmas seems to be involved and focused on the family. And that's a good thing, but also it can exclude a whole load of people for whom family is a complicated thing. Whereas Advent is focused on us being a church. It's about resourcing us as a community together, the church community. Christmas takes you out of the real world. It's a distraction from the real world. It's not like any other day. Whereas Advent takes you into the real world. Christmas is all about the children. Whereas Advent is actually more adult, it's more mature, and it helps us be better adults. Christmas is about the present, no pun intended, but it's about here and now. Whereas Advent is about something that's coming, it's about the future. But what's Advent all about? How do we make the most of it? How does it apply to my life? I hope that some of these questions may be answered over the course of the next few weeks. But let us recap a bit on our journey that we've been on over the last month or so, 2 months, which has been so good for me. The aim of the series that we've been on, the beautiful series, has been to help us and to remind us of the beauty of God and the beauty of his plan to sort out this less than beautiful world that we are living in. And it's been working away on me. I've been taken back again and again to the beautiful way that God doesn't give up on the world, despite the way that we give up on him. Have you been reminded of that too? And we've discovered again, or I've been rediscovered, how his heart breaks as he watches us deface the image of God that he gave us. And so we've discovered that there's a big story that we're part of. The scripture tells a story which is about God getting his world back into order, clean, healed, forgiven, pure and alive. No more death, no more tears, no more fear, no more pain. This is an incredible big story which shapes the way that we see life. Everybody has an overarching narrative, a worldview through which they live life. And we have the Christian story, which gives us a way into how to see all of the nitty-gritty, all of the small things of our lives, the births, the deaths, the illnesses, the jobs, the no jobs. Christianity gives us a way into looking at our lives together. And the story that it tells gives us an understanding of who we are and what the meaning of the world is. The story tells us that we live in an amazingly beautiful world, doesn't it? Isn't that what creation one is all, Genesis 1 is all about? It reveals a beautiful world, and it reveals the nature of God. A beautiful world made in the image of a beautiful God who is beautiful too. And then it reminds us who we are. We are made, every single human being. All of us gathered here today with all of our differences and abilities, our disabilities, all of those things that make us different from the person sitting in front of us and behind us, made in the image of God, made to reflect his beauty in some way, beautifully crafted by God to represent him and to express his rule, just as we are doing this morning, expressing his character in love and care for one another. The big story also tells us that we've got a problem, and it's very clear about the problem, and maybe this is one of the things that has spoken to me most powerfully over the last few weeks, is that I can't avoid the reality of this problem. The story tells us that we have rebelled against this God and against his rule and against his commission. and that as a result of this, that we now live in a contaminated or polluted world where we are contaminated and polluted. And no matter how hard we try, we can't seem to rid ourselves of this disease. It seems as if we're trapped. So, for example, we wage war on evil to rid us of evil, but this only goes to sow yet more evil, which produces more war, which we try and rid with war, which produces more war. And it seems as if we're trapped. Does that ring bells with you? And then the big story that we've been looking at tells us a solution that comes from God. And it's always, right from the very beginning, the solution is always a gift from God. It's never our work that we did. It is always his work that he does for us. It's a gift from God, not something that we figure out ourselves. He sets in motion this strange but beautiful plan that takes time to unfold, but that will ultimately free us and liberate us from the power of sin, free us from the punishment of sin. It will clean up the world from the pollution of sin, and it will reconnect us once again with our Maker and our true identity as image bearers. Now that is a good story. And the start of it is Exodus, and Genesis, Exodus, and Leviticus that we've been going through. And God is fully aware, is he not, of the pain and the brokenness of our world today. Even though the story is ancient, God still looks down on our pain today with an ache in his heart. And I believe that God is waging war against sin and against the enemy, the devil, and that he's desperate to kill off the sin within us which contaminates us without killing us. And we are faced with exactly the same problem ourselves. How do we kill off the sin within the heart of a terrorist, for example, without killing the terrorist? It's a hard thing to do, isn't it? But this is exactly what God wants to do. He's promised not to wipe out the world or to clean it completely up all over again. This is the promise of the rainbow. So he has to bring about another way, a more beautiful way. And this is what Advent is all about. Now you'll see in the picture behind me that that David Lawrence, Mark and Andrew's father, has created a little journey, candle journey route thing for Tori and I, for our family. And each day as we move the candle along, we can read scripture and journey through the story. And we'll start with Genesis and we'll work our way round until we get to Jesus. And there are 25 holes, so that the one in the middle will be Christmas Day. It's great. And we'll have a candle for each day, so there'll be 25 candles in the end. This is what Advent is all about. It's about anticipating the final chapter, not just the chapter in the middle when Jesus is born, but the final chapter of his return when he sorts everything that is currently unsorted in the world today. Everything that is unsorted in your life, unsorted in Twerton, unsorted in our bodies, unsorted in our eyes and our backs and our heads, unsorted in our minds. All of these things that wage war against us, God is waging war against them, and ultimately he will win. And he gives us hope. Now waiting, if you're anything like me, is really hard. But we wait with hope. I just want to let that word drop into your life. I wonder whether you are a person of hope this morning, or whether you're looking at the world with hopelessness or ambivalence, a kind of empty nothingness, or whether you're full of anticipation. Advent is a gift to us because it reminds us to be hopeful again. Hopeful isn't worried. Hopeful is confident of something that you can't yet see. I wonder if there is hope in you this morning. Hope for yourself. Hope for this community. Hope for this building. My goodness. Whether you've got hope for this world, or whether you think it's just going to get worse and worse and worse. Or whether you have in you a seed of hope that God's going to win. Hope is hard to get hold of. And God repeatedly, through the story, places a seed of hope into his people. So Noah, with Noah, he sows a seed of hope, which is the rainbow in the sky. With Abraham, he sows a seed of hope, which is the stars in the night. With Joseph, he sows a seed of hope with some dreams that he has. With Moses, he sows a seed of hope with a crazy, wild staff that he throws down on the floor. With Gideon, he sows a seed of hope with a fleece that he lays out on the ground. With David, he sows a seed of hope through the words of a prophet called Samuel. With Elijah, he sows a seed of hope through a bonfire soaked with water. With Isaiah, he sows a seed of hope through an amazing vision he has. Behold, I see a new heaven and a new earth. With Daniel, God sows a seed of hope through some other wild dreams. In Nehemiah, he sows a seed of hope through the generosity of a king. And then in Mary, beautiful Mary, God sows a seed of hope through her cousin Elizabeth bearing a child. Again and again and again, God acts or speaks and gives his people hope, hope for a future. You see, the reality is that God works in real time. He works his purposes out in real time. He's always working, but he is sometimes frustrated. We have choices that we make, but he is never prevented from working out his ultimate purpose. And so in the midst of this life, he gives us hope. Advent is our time of reconnecting with hope. And we need this, and we need this more than Christmas. Christmas, I don't mean Jesus being born and the story of Christmas. I mean the event called Christmas that we are caught up in. The thing that is like a wave that crashes on us that we can't avoid. That thing called Christmas is a great, fun, fantastic, colourful, red party. It's beautiful, it's crazy, it's exhausting, it's expensive, but hey, let's have a good time. But Christmas is only a day, and it only covers the stuff that we really feel for a day. In some ways, sometimes it actually makes that stuff worse. Advent, however, Advent takes our minds to a future hope. And that hope can sustain us in a way that Christmas will never be able to sustain us. That hope is beautiful. It all started with creation. It began when God created a special place, a place where he could dwell with us, a place, a palace, a garden. And he put us there too, to share that space with him. Heaven touching earth. You know the song, Spirit Break Out? Heaven touching earth. But we rebelled, and the story spiraled out of control. And our land became contaminated and diseased, as we did. And we couldn't live in this beautiful space anymore. And so we are reminded how God gave Moses very clear instructions about creating another space, another place where he could dwell, or tabernacle, which we know means dwelling. A beautiful home where he could reside in. A place where heaven touches earth. And he told Moses how to construct this space, how to decorate it like a garden, how to make it holy and clean and ready for him to fill. And then God dwells among the people and he moves in. Heaven touches earth. And you remember Moses when he sees God, comes face to face. Heaven rubs off on Moses. and he starts glowing in the face of God. And from that day on, there was always a tabernacle, always a temple at the center of God's people, a place where God dwelt. And then the powerful and rich kings who lived in palaces and who ruled the nation wanted to make God a permanent space in which to dwell, not a tent anymore, because they lived in a palace. They wanted God to have at least what they had, better than they had. So they built him a palace made of stones. But the trouble was that their hearts and the hearts of the people were always broken. And no matter how many animals they sacrificed, the people remained contaminated right at the heart of things. As someone brilliantly put, the heart of the human problem is the problem of the human heart. And what God wanted wasn't sacrifices. What he wanted was mercy, something from the heart. What he wanted was forgiveness. What he wanted was justice from the heart. But the people's hearts, like our hearts, were broken or hard or polluted. And so God leaves the temple and he lets a foreign army burn it to the ground and destroy it all. And the people are taken into exile to learn a lesson about their hearts. But God doesn't give up on his people. He knew that they would be adulterous. He knew that they would sleep around. He knew that they would be like a she-camel on heat, sniffing the wind. There's a nice image in Jeremiah. Sniffing the wind, waiting for their mate. He knew, God knew that his people would be an adulterous nation. But he knew that he wouldn't break his covenant. So he marries them, despite their breaking of the covenant. Do you remember the prophet who is asked to marry a prostitute in order to proclaim to the people of Israel, this is what God is like. He will marry you. He will be faithful to you, even though you are not faithful to me. Amazing story. The people are taken into exile to learn a lesson about their hearts. And in this place of darkness and emptiness, this grayness, God sends prophets to speak words of judgment and hope. Judgment, teaching the people what had gone wrong, and hope that one day a new day would dawn, a new morning would break, and the tender compassion of our God will break upon us to shine upon those who dwelt in darkness and the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. So there's this guy called Ezekiel. Beautiful guy called Ezekiel who has this amazing, mind-stretching, exhausting vision. Goes on for chapter after chapter in incredible detail. He has this amazing vision of a new temple being made. A temple coming down out of heaven made by God. A temple way better than anything that's gone before it. A temple filled with God's glory and God's presence. God's dwelling among his people once again. And out of this amazing temple, there was this stream that became a river that flowed out from the center of the temple, out into the world, bringing life to the desert all around it. It was beautiful. It was a picture of the Spirit flowing out to everyone, sweeping them up into his life. But this image, this vision was too big for the people and they couldn't imagine it. It was so far from their experience. It just remained words on a page. It was beyond their wildest dreams. And nothing happened and they entered a period of absence where it seemed to them that God was absent. For years and years and years, decades and centuries. And the vision began to fade, and the hope began to fade almost to nothing. Except there were just a few, Anna, priestess in the temple, Elizabeth, These people who had faith. Zechariah. And they held on in anticipation of the God of faithfulness and covenant. And they looked, and they waited, and they watched. And they gave birth to a son. Elizabeth gave birth to a son, and a man came out onto the scene, a crazy prophet-like man, screaming in the wilderness, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, "Prepare the way of the Lord, make straight paths for him." Would you turn to me to Mark chapter 1 in your Bibles? When you found the page number, shout it out if you found it. 1003 or 1002. Very good. Mark chapter 1, 1002. Verse 4. And so John came, baptizing in the desert region and preaching a baptism of repentance and the forgiveness of sins. The whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him because they were hungry for God to come again. And they confessed their sins because they knew they had learnt their lesson of the hardness of their heart. And they were baptized by John in the Jordan River as a sign of washing. John wore clothes made of camel's hair and a leather belt round his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He had nothing to do with the established world order. He came from another place. And this was his message: "After me will come one more powerful than I, the thongs of whose sandals I'm not worthy to stoop down and untie. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." John came, and he pointed to someone else. Someone who would come, he called the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. And that's what Jesus was. Jesus was the sacrifice, but he was everything we discover that the temple was. He was the bread from heaven, like on the table. He was the one who washed people clean, like the cauldron used outside for washing. He was the one who prayed and interceded, like the lampstand. He was the priest who atoned for their sins. He was the truth embodied in the commandments kept in the Ark of Covenant, in the Holy of Holies. So John describes him. Turn to chapter 1 of John. Turn the page. And turn to page 1063. Turn the page. So John describes him like this. Verse 14. "The Word became flesh and made his tabernacle among us," dwelling among us. "We have seen his glory." That's the word you'd use for a holy temple. "The glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth." John testifies about him. He cries out, saying, "This is he whom I said, 'He who comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me.' From the fullness of his grace, we have all received one blessing after another. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but God, the one and only, who is at the Father's side, has made him known." And this Jesus tells the people that he will destroy the temple, or that the temple will be destroyed, but that he will rebuild it in 3 days. And 3 days after his crucifixion, he was raised to life again, just as he prophesied. Hundreds, even thousands of people began to gather around Jesus, and they began to be filled by the Spirit promised of old, the Spirit that Ezekiel promised over those dry bones, the Spirit that would flow out of the temple, out into the world. And it became clear that this temple was changing, was growing, not with physical stones, but it was being rebuilt with living stones, with us, with people, animated by the Spirit of God, freed from sin, made righteous in God's sight by the washing of the blood, liberated to do good works and to fulfill the words of the law, to love one another and to love God with all their heart, soul, and mind. And so now this is where we live. This is us. We are this temple. We are this place. Paul describes us as a temple of God. We are the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit. And he says, even your bodies, consider your bodies as a dwelling place of the Holy Spirit, which makes us think about how we might use our bodies day after day. But the story is not over yet, because we are still waiting. Are we not waiting? Even though we have the presence of God among us, we are still waiting for the King to return and take his place. So the final chapters of the book go right to the end of your Bibles. Right to the end of your Bibles and find the last chapter but one, Revelation 21. We're going to finish with this. One, two, four, nine. John, not the same one who wrote the gospel, a different John, sees this vision. And once again, it's of this temple. Except for it's also a world like Eden, like the beginning. Verse 1 of chapter 21. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw a holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. He who is seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. And then he said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. He said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and Omega. Or put another way, I am the beginning and I am the end. Have confidence, people of God. I am the end. I am the end. I started this beautiful world. I am the Alpha, but I am the end as well. To him who is thirsty, I will give drink without cost from the spring of the water of life that flows from my temple. He who overcomes, will you overcome or will you lose hope? Will you become twisted and contaminated by the world or will you overcome? Will you remain faithful this Advent? He who overcomes will inherit all of this and I will be his God and he will be my son. But the cowardly, the unbelieving, the vile, the murderous, the sexually immoral, those who practice magic arts, the idolaters and all liars, their place sadly will be in a fiery lake of burning sulfur, which is the second death. Their place won't be allowed, they won't be allowed in this place of beauty when I come and finish everything. Turn the page to the last chapter of the Bible. In the beginning, there was just a garden, a temple garden. Then there was a tabernacle. Then there was a temple made of stone. Then there was a temple made of flesh, the body of Jesus. Then there was a temple made of living stones, us, Jesus' disciples. But the world is still broken and polluted and unclean. But when Jesus comes, a new temple will be birthed upon the earth. Do you remember Jesus' prayer? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. The same temple that is in heaven on earth. The rubbish will be taken away. Verse 22 of chapter 21. I did not see a temple in the city because the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb were the temple. The city does not need sun or moon or light to shine on it, for the glory of God gives it light, and the Lamb is its lamp. The nations will walk by its light, and the kings of the earth will bring their splendor into it. No day will its gates ever be shut, for there will be no night there. The glory and honor of the nations will be brought into it. Nothing impure will ever enter it, nor will anyone who does what is shameful or deceitful, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's book. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and the Lamb down the middle of the great street of the city. On each side of the river stood the tree of life, bearing 12 crops, yielding its fruit for every month. And the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. No longer will there be any curse. Why? Because the throne of God and the Lamb will be in this city, and his servants will serve him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. There will be no more night. There will be no more need for the light of a lamp or the light of the sun, for the Lord God will give them light, and they will reign forever and ever. Advent people, we are Advent hopers. You are destined to reign forever and ever in God's kingdom when Jesus returns. You have been made beautiful. You have been made in the image of God. You have a broken heart. I have a broken heart. And yet Jesus came to restore the image of God in me, in you, to make us worthy of reigning in his kingdom. This is our invitation to our community. We don't just live for this world, we live for the world to come. Everything you do this week will foretell in some way, give people a flavor of the world that is to come. You may be building a school, you may be building a cafe, you may be building a home, you may be building a relationship, you may be building something. Build for the future. Build because you are a son or a daughter of the King of Kings. Be filled with the Spirit, beautiful people of God. Turn away from the enemy. Pray the prayer Jesus taught you. Deliver me from evil. For yours is the kingdom. Yours is the power. Yours is the glory. And I want to be part of that kingdom and power and glory too. We are Advent people. Where do we get this from? Where do we get this hope from in the face of the chaos around us? We get it from the story. The story that was fleshed out in real flesh, in blood and in water, in a man who gave himself for us, but whose death was not the end, who rose from the dead and is alive and who reigns in heaven until he has brought all things under his feet. This is our story. It's the best one. It's the best one.